One of the more popular anime that we have never done a video on before on this channel is Black Lagoon. So we figured, why not? Beware that this is not a children's anime, so some of the themes discussed and the images displayed can be a little bit graphic. That out of the way, I'm Jeremy, and these are 107 facts you should know about Black Lagoon. Number 1. The majority of the animation was done by a studio called Madhouse, probably best known in the US for Beyblade, Death Note, and One Punch Man. Number 2, Black Lagoon, like many anime, is an adaptation from a manga of the same name, specifically the first 9 story arcs. Number 3, and even though the first one saw the light of day in 2001 as a pilot, the manga is still running, currently at its 12th story arc. But there were a lot of years where the release was on hiatus. Number 4, the reason for this sporadic release schedule has a lot to do with creator Rei Hirawa heavily struggling with depression. The good news is that after speaking out publicly on this issue, the outpouring of support has been really big. Number 5, Black Lagoon is also a seinen manga, and by extension, anime, as opposed to a shonen, pretty much meaning the target demographic is slightly older, 18 years and up. Number 6, the show itself has the F-word spoken 259 times, averaging about 11 per episode and about once every 2.5 minutes. Number 7, this actually posed a real problem for Cartoon Network when they aired it on Toonami, as they were forced to bleep out every F-bomb someone drops despite airing at 2 a.m. Number 8, and something that won't come as a surprise to anyone who has seen the show, by far the most of these are spoken by Revy, getting about half that number to herself. Number 9, Revy's voice actress in the English dub, Marika Hendricks, has done quite a lot of voiceover work for Barbie and Bratz movies, and also on My Little Pony Equestria Girls. Quite a departure. Number 10, in spite of, or possibly because of all that, Hendricks has stated that she considers Revy to be her favorite voice role. Number 11, the title of the show itself refers to the PT boat that the Lagoon Company uses. It's an Elko type which was built in World War II by the US Navy, with 326 produced in total. Number 12, but most of the ones that survived the war were later scrapped, with only 2 still existing and only 1 still functional. Number 13, contrary to what the gray paint implies, and seemingly bulletproof nature of the boat in the show, they weren't made out of steel. They were made out of wood, both to save weight and because steel was in very high demand during the war. Number 14. The Lagoon also had its mounted deck guns removed, presumably to cause fewer problems when pulling into ports other than Roanipur. Number 15. Probably the most famous person to actually sail one of these boats in the war was none other than John F. Kennedy. He commanded PT-109, which ultimately sank when it collided with a Japanese destroyer, leaving Kennedy himself with chronic back pain. Number 16, Benny is correct about the design though. When at full speed, these PT boats were designed to have the hull lift mostly out of the water. This combination of high top speed and low draft makes it strangely ideal for a smuggling operation. Number 17, that said, the stunt of them using the sunken ship as a ramp might be possible in theory, but it would have ripped off the propellers and rudders, and would probably also have torn the hull open. Number 18. On Dutch, let's delve into his character a little. He's a veteran of the Vietnam War who went AWOL and escaped into Thailand before the end of the war in 1973. This makes him by far the oldest member of the Lagoon Company, putting him somewhere in his mid-40s. Number 19. Although, there are hints in the manga that he's lying about this, and is instead in his mid-30s, which would make him too young to have fought in Vietnam, and that instead, he's just a regular mercenary. Number 20. He's probably more intelligent than he's letting on, as he is seen reading quotations from Chairman Mao Zedong, and has books by Deleuze, Rousseau, and Hegel on his shelf, and is apparently familiar with Sartre. Number 21. Dutch's design was based on Marcellus Wallace in Pulp Fiction, played by Ving Rhames. This also bled over into his character, having the same generally cool demeanor. Number 22, in fact, the whole series was inspired by that era of Quentin Tarantino movies, the crime thriller Identity where you sympathize with the criminals. Number 23, according to Mr. Chang, Dutch was not the only soldier to escape Thailand, and that instead, Roanipur became something of a magnet to deserters, drug addicts, mercenaries, and psychopaths, bringing the business with them. Number 24, but of course, This business is largely crime-related, what with it being virtually unchecked by law enforcement, and what little of that there is wildly corrupt. Number 25, worth noting, the city of Rwanapur is completely fictional. Although we do see Rock pointing to it on a map in one episode, that location is about the town of Trot, which has about 10,000 inhabitants, not even close to the size of Rwanapur in the show, and there are no giant rocks in the sea near it with Buddha carved into them. Number 26. In the real world, people in Thailand drive on the left with the steering wheel on the right, but in the show, the opposite seems to be the case, most notably on Benny's Plymouth. Number 27. Even for its size in the show, it has a rather extreme concentration of organized crime, being home to Hotel Moscow, the Triad, the Church of Violence, the Italian Mafia, the Colombian Cartel, and, as icing on the cake, the CIA. Number 28. On the Church of Violence, which is probably the most ironically named organization in the show, it's sometimes also referred to as the Rip-Off Church, though why is not really known. Let's just hope it's not literal and instead just referring to their high prices. Number 29. Their main commodity seems to be weapons, and they seemingly supply multiple organizations in Rwanapur. That said, Rock immediately identifies their shipment of laundry as drugs, so they do have business on the side that isn't very publicly known about. Number 30. They do seem to be on pretty good terms with Mr. Chang, and by extension, the Triad. But as far as is shown, he doesn't know about their drug business, only about their weapons trade. Number 31. This leads to something of a strange omission from the show, namely the relationship between the church and Hotel Moscow. In theory, it should be bad, given that they both deal in drugs. Number 32. The only three named characters of the Church of Violence are Yolanda, Etta, and Rico, which seems like a very small number for such a large operation, especially considering they traffic both drugs and guns. Number 33. One thing that doesn't make sense is the pronunciation of Etta's name, given that it's spelled with a single D, implying that it should be pronounced Eda, especially considering it's short for Edith. Number 34. Etta being sent by the CIA to keep international criminal activity in check in Southeast Asia seems a bit counterproductive, given that she isn't exactly a composed diplomat. Number 35. The other person that we see a lot of in the church, Sister Yolanda, is a lot stronger than her frail appearance suggests, given that she has no trouble one-handing the notoriously heavy and powerful Desert Eagle. We don't know the exact caliber gun she has, but even the lightest version weighs nearly 4 pounds. Number 36. Yolanda also seems to be familiar with Etta's connection to the CIA, which suggests that she knows how to play them, or at least not to cross their interests so that she can keep up her business. Number 37. There are also hints that it isn't Sister Yolanda, but instead Mr. Chang who is Etta's contact in Rwanapur, though how exactly that mechanism worked isn't known. Before coming to the City of Pleasure, he was a cop in Hong Kong, quite the career change to move to the Triad. Number 38. In the original version, a background character can be heard commenting on the fact that Chang was a dirty cop who killed his partners, which kind of goes against the reason he himself gives to Rock. Number 39, Chang's design was based on that of Chow Yun-fat's character from the John Woo movie, The Killer. Number 40, that reason isn't completely known, but there is speculation based on his comment that he hates hypocrisy, and that he left the Hong Kong police force because of the corruption within. Number 41, his relationship with Balalaika, and extension, Hotel Moscow, is quite good, although it took some significant peace brokering by Dutch. But now, these two have a pretty deep mutual respect for each other in spite of their rocky start. Number 42. There is also a theory that he is the one who coached Revy, given her unusual level of respect for him and their similar combat styles. Number 43. The fact that Revy is uncharacteristically respectful towards him and even takes well to his constructive criticism does support this theory. Number 44. And that finally brings us to Revy. The hard-drinking, chain-smoking, foul-mouthed, short-tempered, nihilistic, cynical, ultra-violent, heavily armed, merciless, wildly aggressive, brutal sadist who is somehow the most interesting character in the show. Number 45. I say that, but during a popularity contest at the 10th Collection manga release, Revy came in second behind Gretel, who won by 22 out of nearly 20,000 votes. Number 46, of all the characters here, she gets probably the most intriguing backstory, which is part of what makes her interesting. Born in New York, she was raised by an abusive alcoholic father who frequently beat her. But at this point, Revy was still quite a religious girl, and she would only lose her faith later. Number 47, that moment came when she was arrested by corrupt police officers, beaten, and sexually assaulted, which led her to believe that, in her own words, she was just another ghetto rat with no power and no God. Number 48, after this, she went back home to her father, and rather than enduring more of his abuse, she instead grabbed a gun and a pillow and made her first confirmed kill. Number 49, incidentally, the falling feathers that frequently show up throughout the series and in the intro are in reference to this. Number 50, it's never confirmed but definitely inferred by the fan base that her next stop would have been the cops who abused her for the same reason. Number 51, and it's only here that there is a lot of missing information. Revy implies that she has been in prison, though exactly when or even where is unknown. Number 52, probably the most key piece of missing information is how she ended up with Dutch in the Lagoon Company. Dutch is the owner of the boat and the de facto leader. Rock is the rookie, and it's implied that Benny was the rookie before Rock, meaning that Revy was the first one Dutch teamed up with. Number 53. It's also possible Dutch just saw the sheer destructive potential in her and that he was just looking for skilled muscle. Revy is extremely effective when the violence does start, so it's possible he wanted to make sure she was pointing away from him when the shooting started. Number 54, although, with the theory that Mr. Chang was the one who honed her skills with guns, it's possible that her Chinese heritage somehow ended her up in the Triad, and that that's the thing that brought her to Roanipur in the first place, but this is speculation. Number 55. Her proficiency with her two pistols did earn her the nickname Two Hands, but really, Revy is already a nickname. Her full name is Rebecca Lee. Number 56, of course, Revy's signature weapons are her dual Beretta 92FSs, complete with engraving and ivory grips inlaid with the Jolly Roger. Fitting, since there are plenty of people in the show who consider the Lagoon Company to be pirates. Number 57, there are two engravings, one on either side of the slide, one reading 9mm sword cutlass, probably another reference to the pirates thing, and the other being a Thai inscription which translates to manufactured by Priyashat Special Specs, who is a gunsmith in the show. Number 58. The last thing to note is the little bit of extra length she has on the barrel, which provides both more power for the bullet and a little bit more accuracy. Though let's be real, Revy is probably more interested in the power as she seems to operate on a basis of accuracy through volume. Number 59. This also makes sense because even though it looks cool, shooting with one gun in either hand is incredibly difficult to do accurately. Number 60, for whatever reason, educated guess says fan service, Revy never bothers doing up the button on her shorts, and instead relies on a World War II era US Army webbing belt to keep her pants up. Number 61, probably not surprising to anyone, Revy's design was based off of Lara Croft from the Tomb Raider games. Number 62, possibly as a result of her callous disregard for other people, she's by far the most openly racist character outside of the Nazis, usually using slurs to refer to Shenhua and Rock, as well as other characters.
You got that, Chinglish.
Number 63. In early concept art, Revy was shown with much shorter hair than she ended up with in the show, although she is later shown with short hair during flashbacks of her childhood. Number 64. Some people theorize that Revy uses ultraviolence as a coping mechanism for her deeply repressed emotional and psychological issues, and there might be something to that, given that she would have committed some of her most egregious murders on the innocent members of the crew of the ship after going down to the submarine with Rock, whom she doesn't trust at that point, and the only reason she doesn't is because Dutch physically stops her. Number 65. But it's definitely worth pointing out that the people in Roanipur don't see her that way, and pretty much take Revy at face value, seeing her more as a ticking time bomb and hope they aren't in the vicinity when she explodes. Number 66. Because of her abusive upbringing, Revy is obsessed with achieving power, and what she sees as the ultimate equalizer, money. So in a strange twist to the story, the person in charge of the Lagoon Company, Dutch, is not the one most concerned with maximizing the profits. That's Revy. Number 67, with Dutch being much more level-headed, often taking into consideration the risk and feasibility of certain missions, he and Revy work pretty well together, with her being the muscle in case things do go wrong. Number 68, But of course, the starkest contrast with Revy is with Rock. By far the most humane of the Lagoon Company, these two are complete polar opposites, and yet the biggest turnaround she has is with him. At the start, she sees him more like a waste of space, and by the end, it's almost like she sees him as a little brother. Number 69, although, there are plenty of fans who interpret Rock lighting Revy's cigarette with his own as a kiss, but that's really up to you. Number 70, and in spite of that, she did nearly kill him at least twice and possibly more. Although with everything we've discussed about her, that's almost a sign of affection. Number 71. For all her vices, though, Revy displays virtually no outward interest in sex, probably as a result of her trauma. Even when Etta pushes her on whether she's made any moves on Rock, Revy just changes the subject. Number 72. While on that, Etta does seem to have something of a crush on Rock, or at least enjoys teasing him and Revy about it. Number 73. The friendship between those two is interesting, though, as they don't just seek each other out when they are in trouble, but also just for company. And yet, they won't hesitate to pull guns on each other. Again, the CIA not being very picky with their people. Number 74. But let's get back to Rock, technically the protagonist of the show. Though in a neat little gender flip, it's him who gets kidnapped all the time rather than the girl. Revy even berates him for it when he lets Yukio, a teenage girl, get the better of him. Number 75. In spite of his newly found line of employment, he never actually wields a gun. The most notable time he holds one being the one Revy throws at him, which he then immediately throws into the sea. Number 76. Early concept art, however, did show Rock holding a gun, which is probably his own considering he has shoulder holsters in that art too. Number 77. But then again, he doesn't really seem to need one, with Revy never being far from him, and him just being lucky enough to never walk away from a mission with more than bruises. Number 78. Despite taking place almost entirely in Asia, Rock is the only non-American in the Lagoon Company. Number 79, in fact, quite unusually so for a Japanese show, it barely features any Japanese characters, period, outside of the first and last arc, Rock being the only exception. Number 80. This does point at something interesting, especially in the Japanese version, which is the language. Because Roanapur is such a diverse place, they do need a common language, and they seem to have settled on English. The main character speaking Japanese, seemingly in the original, is more for the audience, as Rock does still need to translate for Balalaika in the final story arc. Number 81. We haven't really talked about Balalaika yet, despite mentioning her a couple of times, so let's fix that. Her real name is Sofia Pavlovna, and a balalaika is a Russian guitar-like instrument with a triangular body and typically only two or three strings. Number 82. But it's not in reference to that. Continuing the show's obsession with weapons, she instead took it from her weapon of choice during her military service, a Dragunov sniper rifle nicknamed the balalaika by the Soviet soldiers. Number 83. That said, the nickname most commonly used to refer to her is Fry Face, as a result of her disfiguring scar, although not a lot of people dare to use that name where she can hear it. Number 84. There are many references to her service in the Soviet-Afghan War of the 1980s, where she was a paratrooper and made it to the rank of captain, which her men still frequently call her. Number 85. The media did report on her unit being voluntarily discharged from the military. But knowing anything about the Soviet media, there was probably nothing voluntary about it. Number 86. She is referred to as a Trotskyite, which relates to her father and grandfather's political stances within the Soviet Union. It's worth noting that being a Trotskyite was quite dangerous in Stalin's USSR, as Trotsky was his main political opposition. Number 87. While most recurring characters in the Black Lagoon smoke, Balalaika is pretty much the only one who doesn't smoke cigarettes, preferring cigars instead. Number 88. Hotel Moscow does hold a pretty major advantage over the other crime syndicates of Roanapur, as it mostly consists of former Soviet paratroopers and other special forces. Number 89. But this really isn't enough to earn her much in the way of respect, as she doesn't have much of it from anyone besides Mr. Chang in the Lagoon Company. Number 90. The German U-boat making for Batavia is a bit strange. Many high-ranking Nazis did escape Germany in the final weeks of the war, but they generally went to Argentina, not what was then the Dutch East Indies, even if it was being occupied by the Japanese. 91. So why? probably for the plot convenience. With Black Lagoon taking place mostly in Southeast Asia, it would be a little strange if they suddenly crossed over to the South Atlantic for one job. Number 92. There are a lot of references in the manga to Revy's taste in music, almost none of which made it into the anime for licensing reasons. Number 93. A running gag in the show is Rock being unwilling to wear the Hawaiian shirt Revy got him.
Why won't you wear that Hawaiian shirt I got for you at the market? It's a good fit.
Because we happen to be at work?
And for good reason, as you can see it in the episode Fujiyama Gangsta Paradise.
No wonder we can't make Office Boy here trade these shitty white collar shirts for some real clothes.
Number 94 raises the question, of course, Benny is wearing a Hawaiian shirt. Did Revy buy that one for him as well? Number 95. We don't actually know too much about Benny. All we really know is that he somehow pissed off both the FBI and the Mafia at the same time, and that Revy saved him and brought him on board the Lagoon. Number 96, there are those who claim that his character is based on the investigative reporter Jake Adelstein, but even if that's true, it's a very loose connection. Number 97, there is a good argument to be made that Benny has been largely desensitized to the violence Dutch and Revy use, and that he is what Rock will be after a few years with the Lagoon Company. Number 98, both the manga and the anime are very precise when it comes to guns. All of the design for the guns that they represent are spot on, and there definitely seems to be a theme of rare guns going around. The China Lake pump-action grenade launcher is probably the rarest, with only four existing in the world. Number 99, the only major exception to this is the bar used by Hansel and Gretel, which is actually smaller in real life than it is drawn in the show, even when considering that it's being held by a child here. Number 100. Of course, it's also the most egregious case of the bottomless magazine, as the one shown should only hold 20 rounds. Although most characters are guilty of this, the only character to actually be shown reloading their guns is Revy. Number 101. Alfred, the retired SS officer Dutch talks to on the phone, mentions the Wannsee Conference, which was a real event and implemented the final solution, the start of the Holocaust. However, the Nazis had already begun the genocide against the Jews at that point, and as is fairly common in TV and movies, the historical significance of that specific conference is overrated. Number 102. The Yellow Flag Bar is said to have been destroyed 15 times, with Revy being responsible for most of them, of course. Makes the bulletproof bar seem like a good investment all of a sudden.
Wow, you've bulletproofed the bar, huh?
Number 103, there's a curious parallel with the characters who wear glasses. Dutch and Roberta have their glasses shine in typical anime fashion when they are supposed to be at their scariest. But for Etta, her glasses finally become see-through when she is supposed to be at her scariest. Number 104, Roberta is definitely a nod to the Terminator franchise, specifically the second movie, with some shots being pretty much direct lifts. Number 105, the same song that Revy puts on when blowing up the boats that are chasing the lagoon, also plays during her Whitman fever scene on the Nazi ship. For reference, the song is called Peachhead's Addiction. Number 106, Rock coming to Revy's aid at the end of the Tokyo story arc by pulling the sword out of her leg is precisely what you shouldn't do, and they actually show why. Her wound starts bleeding heavily after that, while the sword was previously stopping the bleeding. Number 107, and given everything, you are not allowed to be surprised when I say that Revy holds the most kills of everyone in the series, totaling 128. And there it is, 107 facts about Black Lagoon. Did you enjoy this show? What interesting fact did we miss? Let us know in the comments below, and remember, Frederator loves you!